Okay, it is my privilege to welcome Johnny Dye to come speak with us. If you thought you had a long haul to get to church this morning, Johnny comes from comes to us from Venezuela. Johnny and Zandra have been serving the Lord overseas for a long time, and many of you have known them for a long time. They're kind of like distant members of this congregation in a lot of regards, but I love that they come and spend so much time with us while they are here. Johnny's going to come speak to us this morning, and he's going to just slip right into our sermon series as much as possible, and so kind of continue on with where we're going. Johnny, would you come up? And congregation, would you welcome him? And just, yeah. Love you, buddy.
You should be worried a little bit. I think I broke the record, the longest sermon the last time I was here. They didn't bother to tell me how long I had today, so. Is there a little clock up there or something? No? Okay. That's good. Kids are dismissed. I'm excited to be here, and I didn't know how excited I was to be speaking to you this morning until my watch just a few seconds ago said my heart rate is elevated unusually. It's either I'm having a heart attack, you know, or I'm just excited or nervous to be up here preaching the Word of God. But it's either going to be a really good sermon or a really bad one. I don't know. But I am really excited. I've been able to gather with you guys and congregate here as much as I can this summer. So you guys have been seeing me around. But I hadn't had a chance to preach, and I was like, I was ready for Sean and for Ben, tag team, you know, like, let me in, okay? I want to get in and share. But I've been enjoying the sermon series, but I'm glad we waited until, this was supposed to be my last week here. We were scheduled to leave to Venezuela on September 11th, so that would have been this week. And then you guys know that there's some political stuff going on in Venezuela, and that they've been in the news a lot. But our flights got canceled. The country we were flying through are no longer friends with Venezuela, as well as many other countries. So now we can't fly through any of those countries. So we're waiting for a new country to open up their doors so that we can make the connection to get to Venezuela. And apparently Curaçao is that country, and we're first in lines to get tickets with them for the 3rd of October. So if you're wondering how long we'll be here, 2nd, actually, we have to go to Miami first. And then on to Venezuela. So that's kind of our itinerary. So thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your patience. Everybody keeps asking me, when are you leaving? I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but I'll take it as a good thing. Sean already started a sermon series about the practical things about the evangelism, right? And the series is about disciples going and doing, you know, what we're supposed to be doing. And I added that supposed to be doing because sometimes we get distracted and we don't do what we're supposed to do. The text for today is in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Verses 1 through 9, and I got a really cool Bible here I'm trying out today. It's got big letters so I can read, but I just noticed it's King James, so sorry if you guys, hopefully there's not too many hard words here to follow. Let's read a scripture. Chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ. It's a great way to start, right? You guys are babes. You guys are carnal. I can't speak to you like Ben and Sean can. Sorry, I got distracted there. But I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it. And even now you are still not able. So you weren't immature before, but you're still immature. For you are still carnal, for where there are envy, strife, and divisions among you, are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? For when one says, I am of Paul, and another says, I am of Apollos, are you not carnal? Who then is Paul and who is Apollos? But ministers through whom you believe, as the Lord gave to each one. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Amen. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Father, I just pray that you use this time, this message, these words that Paul left us here a couple thousand years ago that still apply to our life. And you open our hearts so that we can understand, Lord, and help our open our eyes so we can stay focused and calm our hearts, Lord, so that they are not beating too fast. And in your name we pray. Amen. So a great way to start this series is basically is the way that Paul starts the whole book of Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians is not one of the prettiest books of the Bible. You know, it's Paul, as you could tell, Paul is not like all joyful and all like, oh, I love you guys. You're the best church ever. He's like, you guys are so immature. You guys are like babes. You guys haven't, at this stage, you should be eating like food, but no, you're still drinking milk. I mean, it's pretty bad. And in fact, they say that there was four letters. They say we only have two of them because he mentioned some other letters. And in one of those letters, he even mentions, like, I'm sorry for writing that letter because I that letter hurt you, you know. And apparently it wasn't even this letter. It was worse. So... And it didn't even make the Bible. So it didn't even. He was speaking in his carnal tone of voice. He wasn't like, you know, Spirit, tell me what to tell him. Sometimes we do that, you know, even as preachers, you know. We got to make sure it's the Lord speaking through us. And so the current church has all kinds of problems. And we're not even going to get into it, any of that, because if you read the book, or if you know about the book, I mean, there's all kinds of mess ups going on in this church. And Paul's like, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? What's going on here? He's all worried about the church because they lost the focus. They don't understand what being a Christian is like. They don't understand what the whole purpose of being a Christian, being a disciple and discipling other people. They don't understand about the gospel, preaching the gospel. And Paul even has to say, okay, let's just summarize our purpose as a Christian. And he starts out in the first couple chapters of it's not my heart rate, don't worry. He starts out in the first few chapters saying that, like, hey, let's just focus on the crucifixion. You know, Jesus was crucified. I mean, somebody died for you. Do you understand this? Somebody loved you so much that he died for you. Because we sometimes just forget the basic. How often does somebody die for you? You know? And then at the end of the book of Corinthians, he talks about the resurrection. He says these are the two most important things. Because God didn't just die. He's just so powerful. He resurrected. He's alive. He's still going at this. And that's why we're still going at this, too, because he's not dead. This is not a some kind of religion where, you know, the founder died and, oh, we'll just try to keep this tradition going. No, he's alive, and he's coming back. So he's trying to say, like, you guys are losing focus. What's going on? You're worried about all these other aspects of life. These guys are fighting over who's the best pastor, you know? He's like, oh, Paul's my pastor, you know. And the other one, oh, it's Apollos. He's a mega church pastor now. He's a cool guy. Apparently, he was a dynamic speaker, and he came after Paul and, like, took over this church. And when Paul's gone, and people are like, wow, they like him. Then in another part, it talks about Peter being, you know, people are with Peter. Another one's like, we're just with Christ. Well, that's a good one to be with. But they're fighting over who's their leader. I mean, they're focused. Like, who's got the best church? Who's got the coolest church? Who's got the coolest pastor sermons? You know, who's got the coolest missionaries? You know? They're fighting over these things. And they're so worried about these and other things. This is just like the tip of the iceberg in this book. That they're losing focus on the main thing. I woke up this morning and my heart was racing. Not because I had to preach this morning. But the first thought that came to my mind was, what if nobody shared the gospel ever again to anybody else? What if it like was prohibited and like, or people forgot how to do it, or they just didn't care about doing it? I just woke up this morning feeling like, you know, there's people not sharing the gospel. Today, there's most of us are probably not sharing the gospel on a regular basis. And I was worried. I don't know why, just panic attacks. Like, what would happen? How long does it take for for the gospel to disappear? It just takes one generation of people not sharing the gospel, right? And it's over. I was, most of you are like, man, this missionary, he's always exaggerating stuff. He's I was at the Blair's house. Are they here? No, they're here for the second service. I was having lunch with the Blair's this summer. I was over at their house, and their daughter came over too, and she invited, she had this foreign exchange student in for like 3 weeks. It's not like a student, it's more like a come learn the culture and spend like 3 weeks in the States. And so they had this kid there, they've done it several years in a row, and I've actually met some of the ones in the past, and they come from Spain, and this kid speaks Spanish, obviously, but he spoke no English at all, like zero, okay? And the Blairs, their daughter, she spoke no Spanish at all, zero, right? And so it's been an interesting 3 weeks with this kid, you know. It's like, we're supposed to teach you about the culture and all that, but we can't even communicate with each other. So she was all frustrated. She's like, well, he's got only a 1 week left. And he heard we were going to be at their parents' house. And she's like, I'm bringing the kid over so you guys can talk to him. You know, and it's kind of what we do a lot with the gospel. We bring people so that Ben and Sean can talk to them, right? But so we were like, yeah, bring him over. And he was over there, and the poor kid would just kind of sit in the corner, you know, and do his thing and not talk to anybody because he didn't know how to speak the language. So I was like, well, I guess I have to go talk to him, you know. So I went over there. There's a pool there. We were in the pool. It was very hot. And I was like, so, I'm trying to remember his name. It's the first time I've ever seen him. Simon, I think it was his name. They'll correct me in the second service if I'm wrong. But Simon was there, and I started talking to him about it. So, what do you think about the United States? What do you think about the culture? What do you think about all this stuff? You know, and eventually, you know, the Holy Spirit's like, okay, you're not just going to talk to him in Spanish and stuff. You're going to talk to him about God. So, get to the point. Come on. And, So I'm running through all the basic stuff, you know, trying to build a relationship there in a few seconds, and trying to get some trust. Eventually, I was like, well, how do I get this conversation started? So I'm like, okay, so you've been seeing the city, the culture, and everything. Have they taken you to an American church? And I was like, I think they go to, the mom goes to Rivers Crossing, maybe. So it's a big church, you know. Have you gone seen, you know, have you been to that? Have you seen the churches here? They're like really big. It's like modern and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And he says, no, they haven't taken me to the church yet. Well, he doesn't speak any English, so he's not going to understand anything anyway. So I was like, well, can't blame them, you know. But just so they can get the experience, I thought that maybe they would take him. And so it's up like, so my follow-up, actually, it was his follow-up question. He's like, actually, I've never been to church. And I was like, okay, like back home in Spain, you never been to church? No. I mean, like Catholic church. You know, I don't mean like Protestant church because everybody in Spain is Catholic, right? So he's like, no, I've never been to a Catholic. Well, maybe I think I went to a baptism of somebody at one time when I was little. I was like, oh, that's really weird. So I was like, oh man, this is good. I'm gonna preach to this kid. You know, I'm gonna, you know, the field's ready. You know, so I started like talking to him. So let's talk about like I don't know how it went. I mean, my brain was like, okay. What's next? So I'm trying to preach the gospel. You know, I'm trying to plant some seeds there in this heart because I'm never gonna see this kid again. You know, that was the only day I only had a few hours to talk to him. So like, how much can I tell him in a few minutes or hours, you know, that will make an impact for his life? Like, so poor kid. He did not know what was coming. By the time we were out of that pool, I mean, we're all shriveled up, you know. We'd been in there that long. But we started from, like, I started, like, just some, you know, I said, you know, Jesus. Let me start with Jesus and stuff. His face was, like, blank. And I was like, you know who Jesus is, right? And he was like, are we speaking a different language? And I was like, no, I'm speaking Spanish here. No, his face was blank, and I don't understand. I wasn't, like, even connecting. I was like, you know, Jesus from the Bible. He's like, oh, I've never read the Bible. So you don't know the story of Jesus? He's like, well, I think I might have seen a movie one time or something, but I don't remember. So I was like, okay, so you tell me you never gone to church, never read the Bible, never heard of Jesus. I was like, I can't. I think he's pulling my leg. And I think this is a test or something. I don't know what the Holy Spirit was doing. So I was like, okay, can't be like that. So it's like, okay, so you were talking about Easter, and we were talking about Easter earlier, and how he gets a long break. And it's like, do you even know what they celebrate in Easter? What are they celebrating? He's like, I don't know. It's a holiday. It's the biggest holiday, whatever. It's like, it's the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. And he's like, really? I didn't know that. I was like, okay, next with Christmas. You know what Christmas is about, right? He's like, no, it's just we celebrate. We have. He's never heard anything about the gospel. This is like a 17-year-old kid. And all of a sudden, I started panicking. And I started worried. I was like, how is this possible in the culture today? I mean, there's internet, there's movies, there's everything. Everybody's heard the gospel somewhere, right? Even like in remote villages. We have churches planted in like this remote village in Venezuela where you can only get there in these little canoes, hours getting there. And the whole village is completely Christian. Somebody got there with the gospel at one point, and we sent one of our pastors in to do a training this year. And he says, everybody, like 99% of the people in this community are Christian. I mean, it's a small community. It's like a couple hundred. The remote area. They don't even have electricity or anything over there. And like, how does this kid not know the gospel? Let me tell you, people, it can happen in our generation. It can happen. People are afraid to speak up. People are afraid. I don't want to offend anybody. I don't want to, you know, hurt anybody. I don't want to insult anybody. So sometimes we don't speak up. We don't plant the seed. And then it can happen on our guard. Any farmers here? I know there was some here. I know at least if you're not a farmer, a lot of you have gardens and stuff, right? I know a guy back there, he plants a lot of tomatoes. I've eaten his tomatoes. Did he bring any this year? I was waiting for him. It's like, what's the Sunday that he brings all the leftover tomatoes of the season? Is it hit yet? Did I miss it? No? I took like boxes of that home. I didn't know how I was going to eat them all. But farmers, right? No farmers here. Just a little. So anyways, farmer, what would it take for food to run out in the country or in this world? It doesn't take much. It would just take for the farmers or whoever plants the seed to decide not to plant them. We're not going to plant them this year. You know, we're not going to plant anymore. We're going to go, you know, work at something else. We're no longer going to be farmers. We're not going to plant any more seeds. How long would it be before we run out of food? You remember COVID, you know, right? You guys experienced a little Venezuela during that time, you know. There was like, there's a lot of stuff going on, but one of them was like these truckers that bring all the shipment and all the food. They were like on strike, right? Truck drivers, you know. And they were on strike, so like none of the stuff was getting here. And it doesn't take long for you not doing the right thing to total chaos and collapse, right? And so what would happen if Christians did not plant the seed? What would happen? There would be no food, right? There would be no more Christians. So how important is it for you and me? A lot of times we think, well, the farmers, they're in charge of planting the food, right? You know, we'll leave it to them. And we do the same thing with Christianity. The pastors, the leaders, they're in charge of doing the job. We'll leave it to them. Well, hopefully there'll be food next week, next month, next year. Hopefully there'll be Christians next generation. We can't just leave it up to other people. So one of my questions is, which one are you? You know, there's like three people involved in the story. You know, Paul says he's the one that planted. We're in verse 6. Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So there's three people involved in this process, right? The one who plants, the one who waters, and the one that makes everything grow. I like the third one the most, you know. He's like, he invented this whole system, you know. He's the one that, we don't know what's happening. I'm the worst farmer ever. But sometimes, I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to grow a garden, right? So I took some tomato seeds, and I took some corn seeds, sweet corn here, to Venezuela because I like the tomatoes they have here. And I took it to Venezuela. I was like, oh, how hard could this be? You know, I threw it in some soil. I have like a little garden window in my apartment. I live on the third floor? Yeah, okay. I don't even, my watch. I live on the third floor, and you have a little windowsill, and we planted, first year I did some tomatoes, and I was like, okay, tomatoes, and so water. I throw some water on the things, and I see these little plants starting to grow, and I put some more water on it, keep growing, and, you know, 3 months later, I have the amazing tomato. I had like I threw all kinds of seeds in there. I don't know what, but I had yellow, red, you know, orange, all kinds of different tomatoes, little, big. And these things are growing all over my window. My neighbors are looking. It's like, what's going on over there? They can see in through our window, and all these fruits are coming out. I was like, man, I'm the best farmer ever. This is like my first try. I was like, I'm in the wrong business, you know. And we ate those. I mean, we ate those tomatoes. They were delicious. So another thing I throw. It's like, okay, this worked. Let's throw some corn seeds. I threw some corn seeds in that same patch after 3 months. What? Why are you guys laughing? Some farmer sure knows how to. No. It's not what you think, you know. It worked, actually. The corn grew. Big corn. I only had like 7, 8 plants, so I got 8 corns, ears of corn, or maybe a couple more extra. We'd split it like in 3 pieces and share it every lunch. It's like, we get 1/3 of a corn. That's all we get. We got to ration this thing out. We don't know when in the world we're going to get this corn again. So I was so excited. It's like, first time I plant tomatoes, first time I plant corn, they grew. It's like, this is easy. This is the best thing ever. So it's like, what's next? Like, well, let's go back to tomatoes. So immediately they cut the corn down, put the tomatoes in. Nothing. They started growing. They all died. They got all kinds of germs and stuff, bugs and white stuff all over it. I think every disease possible hit that thing. It was like Sodom and Gomorrah. I mean, nothing. I didn't even get it. I mean, there was one that bloomed. It was like the tiniest thing. I was like, hello, what happened here? I don't know. I have no idea. How did I mess this up? This was so easy. You just plant it and pour some water on it, right? And it was terrible. I was like, well, I'll go back to corn. Because corn worked really good. Planted the corn. They grew about this big. Little tiny corn about this big. It's like, I can't split that in three parts. You know? I was very disappointed. I was like, what happened to my luck? I mean, like, everything is destroyed. I was like, I'm the worst farmer ever. How did I mess this up? It's just, you know. Well, with the corn, I figured out that half of the year, there's no sun on that side. And without sun, the corn won't grow at all. I didn't know that. I mean, there's a light coming in, as I thought it was enough, but they like straight sunlight on it. Even though we have perfect weather in Venezuela, there's no winter. I mean, it's always summer, basically. And but I didn't know it didn't work. So somehow I messed it up. I couldn't get tomatoes ever to grow back. The corn, I could get it to grow back only 6 months when the sun was on that side of the house. And I realized, like, there's a lot of ways you can mess this up, too. I mean, it's supposed to be really easy. I mean, God is the one that makes this thing grow, you know. But you just have to do some basic things. You need to make sure, you know, you plant the seed. Nothing's going to grow if you don't plant anything. You got to make sure you water it, right? Nothing's going to grow even though you planted something if you don't water it. So I learned some basic things. Now, when we think about the gospel and how this applies to the gospel, because this is Paul talking about this. And actually, Paul's purpose here was not to teach us how to evangelize. He did not want to give us the principles that we're sharing today. His job was like, why are you guys talking about who's Apollos and who? We're all the same. I mean, it doesn't matter who planted, who watered, or whatever. It's who makes the seed grow. And he went on to some other subjects and start, you know, complaining and telling them how they're messing up with some other things. But his point wasn't even to teach us this. But today we just got this awesome principle here that we didn't even intend to have, because it's not a principle about planting churches or anything or evangelism in this chapter. It's a how the Christians aren't doing their job. They're focused on the wrong thing, and that's part of the planning, believe it or not. Because if we're focused on the wrong things, we're not going to be successful. So how easy it is to mess this up. You know, you plant, you water, God does the rest, right? How easy is it to mess this up? I was at this concert last night. A lot of you guys were there too. Rock the Park, right? Yeah? Anybody was there? I saw some of you guys there. You guys did not see me, right? I was in the front row. I was rocking. You know, my ears are still ringing. My daughter wanted to be in the front. I was like, oh, I'll be up there with her. You know, I'll pretend I'm still, I don't know, 20, 15, whatever. So we were up in the front, very front. I mean, we had the sweat of Toby Mac was hitting us. And we were like, it was fun. Until Toby Mac gave his testimony. And Toby Mac said that he was, you know, he met the Lord when he was 13 years old. But then after that, he's like 50-something now, right? He looked old, especially if you're like in the front row. I mean, I look younger than him. I was excited about that. And he says this. It's like, I've been a Christian all my life, you know, been to church and all that kind of stuff. But it wasn't until like 5 years ago, like during COVID or something, that I decided that I need to read my Bible. I've never read the whole Bible. I mean, I knew some verses here and there, and I'd never read it. And I started getting disappointed. I got upset. I was ready to go to the back row. I was like, this guy's been ministering to me with his music for like 30 years. I mean, he's been around for a while, right? DC Talk, remember that? Anyways, this guy's been ministering to me for so long. And this song's like have helped me in different areas of my life. You know? I knew all the songs and everything. And I was like, how's this guy now telling me that he's never read the whole scripture? And when he finally decided to read it, tragedy hits his house. His son died, his firstborn son, college age. And he said he put the Bible down. He had started to read it again. And he said, I put it down. I said, I didn't open it for for a long time again. Until God started working in his life. But I was ready to go and burn all my CDs. You know, I was like, this pagan, he's been lying to me. What kind of Christian? I thought this guy was, I mean, his lyrics are amazing. And I was ready to burn his CDs and everything. And then I thought, you know, and I thought this is how sometimes God works. God can use a donkey to speak, right, to people. He can use anybody. Most of us, the reason we don't plant the gospel or we don't water the gospel is we think we don't have the tools. We think we don't know enough. We don't have all the Greek and Hebrew. We think we're not capable. We fear a lot of things, and we decide just not to. But you don't have to be Bible college student. You don't have to be a mature Christian to share the gospel, to change lives. And God's used Toby Mac and many other worship leaders. I just want to make sure. You guys should go buy his stuff. I mean, it's good stuff. You know, I realized I was wrong. I mean, God uses anybody. I mean, it doesn't matter what level you are in your faith, whether you've read the whole Bible every year or not, you know, God can use you and change thousands of lives if you let him. If you just plant the seed or if you just water the seed, you know. So we'll get back to Toby Mac later if I have time. But so there's a few principles here that we can still mess things up. And one of the worst things, the reason we don't usually plant the seed of the gospel, we don't preach the gospel to others, because that's kind of what plant is, right? Remember that? Jesus explained it in another parable. He said, you know, the sower went and he was planting seeds everywhere and he threw it in different places and on hard ground, on good ground, on rocky ground, on thorny ground. And the seed tried to grow in every place it fell. I mean, because that's what it does, you know. It tries to grow because it's natural, right? You can't really mess that up. But it doesn't always grow the way you expect it. We don't know that. We don't know which one's a good ground or not. Sometimes we just assume everybody's a bad ground. So we're not going to waste our seed. We're going to save our seed until we find some good ground. But we don't know who's a good ground, who's a bad ground. I'll just give you an example of this. I was in Venezuela. I love witnessing to strangers. And my daughter plays soccer. And it's a great thing because when I take her to soccer, all the parents are there and watch their kids. And we're there for an hour and a half, and we have nothing to do. So I get a lot of chances to talk to them about my faith and about the Bible and the gospel throughout the years I've been doing this. And I usually pick my people, you know. I was like, I'm looking for the good soil, you know. I don't want to waste my seeds on, you know, just any soil, you know. I'm like, oh, this person looks like interested. He looks... You know, but we don't know that. And God doesn't tell us, like, go pick out the best ground. You know, he just plant that. You know, I'm in charge. I'm the one that decides whether it's good ground or not, you know. So I'm witnessing. I'm always like this. And many times I'm not effective at all. Because, you know, I'm thinking with my head, with my logic, who's the right person, you know. And then I end wasting those gospel seeds, right? So I was preaching. I saw this one kid. He's a soccer player, about 18 years old. He liked talking to me while he waited for his sister to train. And sister trained with my daughter. And we were waiting there. And I was like, hey, you want to come to church with us? You know, Sunday we have a lot of youth in our church. And he's like, yeah, I'll go. And I was like, okay, well, that was easy. Good soil, you know. So the kids showed up at church that Sunday, and I was like, well, and we said, hey, why don't you just come out with us, and we'll have lunch, and you can hang out with us, and we'll play some games in the afternoon and do some stuff together. And, yeah, so guys, the kids stayed with us all day long. So next Sunday he was there, and next Sunday he was there. And every Sunday he'd come and hang out with us afterwards, eventually, I was like, one night he was late at our house, and I had to. It's like, call your mom. I know his parents from soccer. It's like, tell me you're with us, you know. And she's like, you don't have to call them. They don't care where I'm at or whatever. It's like, you know, I'm a parent. Call your mom. Tell them I'll bring you home and everything. It's like, okay. So he calls her mom, and he tells her, I'm over here with the Dyes. And they're like, what? Dyes? Yeah, I went to church with them today, and I stayed with them all day. Church? What are you doing at church? And mom, it's like, he's never been to church in his life. I mean, this kid wasn't good soil, apparently, according to his parents. You know, this kid's never been to good. I mean, he's been going through this rebellious state with his parents. He's like, the parents were so intrigued. He's like, we're going Sunday. We're going to find out what's going on. That's some kind of, you know, sect over there at that church. I don't know what they're doing. They're brainwashing kids. Or I was like, something weird's going on. My kid would never go to church. So they showed up Sunday. And their mouth dropped too. They were worried about their kid and everything. But then they came for the service and they worshiped. And they heard the gospel. And I made an invitation at the end of the sermon. And the mother started walking forward. She was holding the husband's hand. And the husband is a big guy. Big hands, like twice my hands. Intimidated. I think that's why I never preached to him. He's an Italian guy. And he's a couple years older than I am. Definitely bigger than me. So, but the lady starts coming forward. And the guy's like holding her hands. Like, hey, where are you going? We just got here. You don't know what's going on. What are they're going to brainwash you to? I don't know what he was thinking, but he doesn't let her go forward that Sunday. So after the service, I was like, hey, you enjoy the service and everything? And they're like, yes, it was very good service. I loved it. I was coming forward. I've never been to a church like this. I've been to many churches in my life. I've never heard the gospel preached like this. I never understood it. You guys explained it in a way that made sense to me. And it was like, so next Sunday was like going to be like Easter Sunday or something. He's like, we were going forward, but my husband's a little shy. And he's like, no, I ain't going forward. We need to talk to John. We don't even know what's going on here. So I don't know what we're going forward to do. So during the week, we talked a little bit. And he's like, oh, okay. So you're not going to do some weird thing on me or something like that. So next Sunday, they're both in tears during the service. They both come forward and give their life to the Lord. They were baptized that same Sunday. They've been to many churches all their life, considered themselves religious, but they never experienced the presence of God in their life. The son was mad. Because now the parents started coming to their cool church, and the church wasn't cool anymore. So the kids stopped coming to church, you know. And but they never stopped coming to church. They're one of the faithfulest couples in our church. And they've been through some hard times. Her daughter ran away from home. The kid dropped out of school, dropped out of everything. They didn't want to know anything about Christ, anything about nothing. They have a special needs kid that's like 19 years old, doesn't talk, never has. And he comes to church with them all the time. And they've been through some trials the last few years with their kids and their family. You know, sometimes we preach, you know, come to Christ and everything's going to be good. You know, God's going to bless. It's the best thing ever. For them, it wasn't because of that, the kids rebelled against them more because they wanted them to come to church with them, and they were trying to force them to do that. And so the kids actually left home. Well, the boy's back home because he doesn't have a job. So, but the girl, she's in Spain now. So sad. The thing is, the stories, there's a lot of cool things in the story, but one thing is you don't know who is the one that God wants to minister to. The person you think is going to be the most receptive may not be the most receptive. The person you think is the least receptive, you know, ends up being the most receptive. So you don't know. It's like the seed. I mean, you plant the seed, you don't know what's happening underneath the dirt, right? Bible says that seed needs to die before it comes to life, right? It's a break, fall apart, and before a new life starts coming out. You don't know what's happening in the lives. You invest in them. We plant, and we're patiently waiting to see what God's going to do, right? Sometimes it's planting the seed for the first time. Sometimes it's watering the seed, and that takes some time. I've done a lot of planting, and I've done both a lot of watering. Which one are you more familiar with, planting or watering? Let's say watering is more the follow-up. It's like spending time, getting that person to the next level, discipled. And planting is probably just giving, you know, the gospel the first time, speaking to somebody about the gospel the first time. Which one are you good at? Are you good at talking to strangers? Are you good at talking to people about the gospel, the basics? Or are you good following up, being that person that hangs out with them and disciples and spends times with them? I'm both. I think you're both too. I think it wasn't more like, you know, Paul's only the planter and Apollos is only the waterer. No, because Paul's watering right here. He's trying to take out a bunch of messes in the church. He's trying to fix some things up. So he's watering too. God's the one that does the growth. But we do the watering. And sometimes we get discouraged because it takes a long time. You know, when I'm planting those seeds, I'm there every day. Like, I mean, I don't have much else to do, you know. It's a little garden. I mean, I put all my faith in these little seeds, and I'm there watching them grow. One time, I tried some new things. Let's do flowers because I don't forget corn and tomatoes. They're not coming back in my garden. So I said, let's do flowers this year. I planted a bunch of seeds, and I watered that stuff. And I was every day, I was like, ooh, look at all these things. All of a sudden, I think I planted too much because I see, like, 150 plants, and I think there was only, like, 10 seeds. I'm like, what kind of seeds are these? It's like, multiply. So all these things are growing. My daughter's with me. It's like, look at this. This is incredible. It's like this whole patch of stuff. As it grew and grew, we discovered there were weeds. I was growing weeds. I was so excited. I was pouring water every day on these things, taking care of them. There were weeds. The flowers, they got choked. I don't know what happened to the flowers. They never came out. I don't know where the weeds came from. I didn't plant no weeds. It's complicated. I mean, sometimes we're investing our time in the wrong stuff in life. So, and sometimes it just takes too long. I was you guys' age right here in the front, college age, and I was on my way to a mission trip to Venezuela. My parents were serving down there, and I was coming out. I was in college. So I took the summer and went down there on the plane. Two college girls sit next to me. That sounds pretty exciting, right? I was still single. Don't worry about Sandra. And so I'm on this plane, and God kind of does this thing to me always. My phone, you know, my heart rate goes up or something. That means I have to preach to them, right? No. But, you know, when God puts something in your heart, you have to do it. So talk, small talk with people next to you on the plane like we always do. And then eventually it's like, okay, I'm going to tell. They're like, so why are you going to Venezuela? I mean, you're American and everything, blah, blah, blah. It's like, well, missionaries, you know, my parents are missionaries. I'm studying in a seminary. Oh, so we start talking about the gospel. This is before internet, phone existed, yes. But it was expensive, long distance calls. You had to pay for that. And so the flight, 2 hours long, I'd preach them a good time. And I was like, well, there's no internet, there's no nothing. Give me your address. I mean, maybe I'll follow up with a letter. I mean, that would take a lot of work, right? So I get these girls' address. One of them wasn't very interested. I wrote her, and she never answered. The other one was like, oh, I like what you're talking about. Tell me more. I send her a Bible in the mail. Like, I had to pay for, like, shipping in and everything as a college kid. I was like, this costs me. And I had to wait weeks and weeks, no answer, to know if there's any reply. So I sent these letters, and I said, read these verses, is everything. I found out that the students in our school was going to do an internship in the city that where she was on the other side of the country, Phoenix, Arizona. He was going to do the same internship in that city. So I connected them. I said, like, hey, this guy's going to this church. Maybe you want to visit that guy's, this church. And he's doing the youth and everything there, college ministry. So after a while, you know, this long letter, nobody responds, you know. So I figure nothing happened. So fast forward 25 years later. 25 years later, I never heard of this person again. And I only wrote him like twice, sent him a Bible. That's it. Planted some seeds. Who knows what happens? Most of the time, nothing happens. 25 years later, I'm preaching at this church in Miami, Florida. A missionary friend was planting a church there. And he had a small congregation, about 25 people. I was preaching that Sunday. And he introduced me to the congregation. And after that, we went out to lunch with some of them, and they introduced me to some of them. One of them, the person's name was Ivanova, and I thought, that's a kind of odd name. I've never heard that name before. You ever heard of Ivanova? Me either. But then I thought, hold on a second. I met an Ivanova on a plane 25 years ago, and I sent her a Bible. It's like, no, there's no way that this is the same person. I mean, it's 25 years later. You know, they don't look anything like. I mean, I didn't look like myself either. So I was like, so we're eating lunch, and I was like, do I even ask? You know, it's kind of awkward. You know, do you remember 25 years ago taking a plane to Venezuela with some college students sit next to you and shared the gospel with you? And her eyes just got big. She's like, yes. I thought that when I heard your name, you got a weird name too. I was like, it's Johnny Dye. I mean, like, I remember that name. I remember her name, kind of, sort of. But I was like, yeah, I was that girl on the plane. I lived in Phoenix. I said, what? She's been married, had kids, been divorced, all that. Found this church, my friend's church. So we started talking, and I asked her, so tell me your story. I want to know. I mean, it's like, this never happens. And I'm asking her the story, you know, and everything. So I finally get to her, she's like, so hold on a second. So at what point did you get baptized? What year and everything? And she's like, I haven't been baptized yet. I just started coming to this church like a few weeks ago or months ago. You're like, you're kidding me. We're getting that done. Thank you, Lord. 25 years later, we're getting you baptized. She's like, okay, whatever. You know what? So we explained the whole baptism thing. I was in town only for a couple of days. So I was gone before she was baptized. But they FaceTimed me. The pastor FaceTimed me like a week later. He's like, we wanted you to see the baptism and they did it in the ocean. It's pretty cool. 25 years later, it's just amazing how God works. You know, most of the time we think it doesn't work. We did this ministry in Caracas for many years. We went to this park after church. We took almost the whole congregation. We ate like picnic and stuff. And we did this for several years. Every Sunday, you know, anybody wants to come, we'll have a picnic at the church and we're going to evangelize people. We're going to share the gospel. We do balloon animals. We do all kinds of entertaining stuff to get people. And people would be sitting underneath a tree, you know, at these parks, you know, with a blanket and just minding their own business. And we just walk up. It's like, you want a free balloon animal for the kids, or do you want whatever? Whatever we had that week. We face painted people. We did everything to get some. To attract them, let us talk to them, you know. And we preached to so many people there. We did skits. People would gather like 200s. And we hardly ever saw like they'd end up at church after that. But we kept planting. I mean, we kept doing it. People would like give their life to the Lord, but then they wouldn't show up at church. Next Sunday, it's a big step in Venezuela. It's funny because when we preach the gospel, we want the people we preach to be the missionaries. We want them to come to our culture, to our weird setting, to our little temple and steeple and chairs and, you know, lecture and our culture and our language. We want them to come to us to get evangelized. It doesn't work that way. We're supposed to be the missionaries, right? We're supposed to go to their culture and meet them where they're at and explain the gospel in a way that they understand and not bring them to this weird setting, you know, to hear some Venezuelans speak, I don't know, with a weird accent. That's our way of evangelizing, right? Making the people be the missionaries. We almost want the seed to, I don't even have a good illustration for that, but we have to water, we have to plant. It doesn't happen by itself. Sometimes it takes a long time, sometimes it don't. And sometimes it's awkward, but it works. So even if you're awkward at it, try it. We had a little ministry in Venezuela a long time ago where we played soccer and during the week, and we invite youth to come and play soccer with them. And after we made friends with them, we, you know, invite them to church or preach the gospel, whatever. But it was like an outreach thing, but we played soccer, which it was fun, and I enjoyed it. So I was at this one game, and some friends invited this guy named Saul to to our friendly soccer match, And he was playing against me, and I get this pass. I mean, I like scoring goals, you know. I get this pass. It's a lob. It was coming like floating in the air, and I'm getting ready. I was thinking I'm like Cristiano Ronaldo. I was gonna do like a backflip, and you know, I imagined being doing all this really cool thing to just put it in the net, win the game. The ball it took forever. It's like, what is that thing coming down? I was ready for it. Man, I had practiced this shot on my own in the house before. So this thing was coming. I was like, this is my glorious day. I've never seen the perfect ball. The net's over there. Nobody's in the way. And this ball comes down, and just I swung it. I nailed it so hard. I was like, oh, this is perfect. I looked down. I did not nail the ball. Saul got in the way. At the last minute, he tried to defend the thing. He jumped in the way, this visitor that was there for us. And I was looking up. And I was like, praise Jesus. You know, this thing's coming. And he was low. He was trying to, he's scared of what's going to happen. He should have been scared because I hit him in the butt like so hard. It felt good, actually. I was like, man, this is going to go. The guy got off the ground. That's how hard I hit him. He didn't make it to the net, but I felt so bad. I felt so bad. It's like, this guy's never coming back to church. I was like, I'm so sorry. I was like, I'm really bad. I don't know what was going through my head. That kid became a Christian. He's like, that's the kind of pastor I want in my life. He'll kick my butt if I get out of line. He's now the associate pastor of my church. He's preaching there probably right now or in a couple hours. He's an associate pastor at our church. We got another associate pastor. Not associate pat. Associate pastor. I can get in trouble with this language thing. So we call them pastors. I know you don't call them that. It's like one time I was saying pastors, and somebody's like, we don't say that in our movement. The Baptists use pastors. We use ministers. I was like, we can't do ministers in Venezuela because it sounds like somebody works for the government, minister of defense, minister of interior, whatever, these ministers. So if I tell them I'm minister, they're like, oh, you work for the government. It's like, no, I'm a minister of religion or the gospel. They were like, oh, pastor. It's like, yeah, pastor. So there's no way around it. We're pastors in Minnesota. So what was I saying? Oh, yeah. So anyway, these pastors, this other kid, we were at this camp, and there's this 15-year-old. No, actually, he's like 17. He was helping me at the camp. First camp, first time at a church, first time hearing about the gospel. Spent a whole week at camp, you know, hearing the music, the preaching, and everything. And then it was like, okay, seed's been planted. It's time to water. So watering involves spending time with people and stuff. So it takes time. It's not as easy as planting sometimes. So I don't know which one are you. But this kid, I was like, I got a good idea. I need some help loading all the stuff, all the sound system and all the stuff. We take it back to my house. And so I was like, I need some strong guy. He wasn't very strong. He was skinny and tiny. Well, I need some strong guy to help me and ride with me and not with the bus. So I was like, this is my opportunity. So I asked Luis to get in the car with me. I was like, oh, man, I'm going to preach to him the whole way there, and this guy's going to change his life. And so I'm on this in the truck, and I start asking him questions. Like, I got him for like 2.5 hours. Like, this guy, you know, he's not getting away from me. This is the first time me talking to him, person to person. I was trying to water. Sometimes we overwater, right? I mean, this is the thing. You can kill the plants, overwatering. Underwatering, we know that. I mean, we're really good at that. But sometimes we overwater. I'm the overwatering kind of guy. And so this guy's 2 hours stuck in the truck, 2.5 hours stuck in this truck with me. And I'm asking him questions. I'm sharing, you know, telling some illustrations and stuff like that. And he doesn't say a word the whole 2.5 hours. He nods his head, you know, up and down. Once in a while, I actually got a yes or something out of his mouth. Doesn't speak anything. I was like, this kid, he's not good soil. Nobody can be in the truck for 2.5 hours with me and not, like, be converted or something, you know? That's what I was thinking. This kid's like, no emotions, nothing, you know, just little body language, not good body language. Like, oh, well, I tried, Lord. He's our other co-pastor now at the church. It took a while for him, but he came around. Sometimes it takes a while of investing. You have to be patient, right? Sandra's got a family member. Her name's Rachel. It's like a second cousin or something. And when I was a youth pastor at the church, we tried to get her. Some of her family was coming to church. We tried to get her involved, and she came to a couple of our sessions. You know, we thought she was going to stay, get baptized, all that kind of stuff. But it ends up she didn't stay with us. Her family did, but she didn't. She walked away from the gospel. She walked away from the gospel. And I never saw her again. I still haven't seen her again. She got her life in trouble. She got married, had kids, got divorced, left the kids with the dad. And I was like, well, that we planted that seed, but it didn't work. This year, this young girl came to our church. She's like, hey, I'm related to you, Sandra. You know, this girl's like, my mom is your second cousin, so I don't know what that makes me, but we're related. I was like, okay, everybody's related on there, you know, somehow. So we were related. And I was like, so we start seeing the story. She's like, oh, you're the daughter of Rachel. And I was like, well, I'm so sorry to hear about your mom, you know, and everything, how your life turned out. So she started coming to our church. She was baptized, faithful attender at a church. This summer we were gone. She went on a mission trip to the Boy Scouts of Venezuela. Not the Boy Scouts. I mean, it's both girls and boys. But are they called the same? Just Boy Scouts, yeah? Both? Scouts? Well, okay. They went on a mission trip to Scouts. They wanted somebody from their church to have a station there for the kids every day of the... it was a nationwide camp. And they invited some people from our church. The only two people available was her and another kid that's never been on any evangelism trip. So I'm like, oh, this is all we got. And we sent them there. And I got some videos this week. She was preaching to like 400 kids, 400 scouts, praying with them. Kids were accepting the gospel. And I was like, wow. You know, I was attending her mom to receive Christ and to be this person. It was a daughter. That wasn't even born. And now she's preaching to tons of people in the world. God can use anybody. We need to plant. I want to finish with this short video of some of the baptisms we just had this summer before I came up. But there's the first few images is of her at the Boy Scout place. You know? And my call is, as you're watching this video, is think, you know, can God use me? How powerful is my life? You know? How powerful is what I can give? You know? Let's see this video.
Some days life feels perfect. Other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing. We can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak life. Just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well, it's crazy to imagine words from my lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak life.
Let's pray. I bought this shirt at concert Toby Mac last night. It says "Speak Life," and that's what God wants you to do. You know, that's what planting is about. It's about sharing the seed of life, people.
If you liked what you saw here, go ahead and click on that like button. And while you're at it, for more great content, go ahead and subscribe to our channel.